Hi, YouTubers! How are you? And welcome to part one of PC upgrading for video editing. Now, what's interesting about this is what I decided to do. I need to be able to start editing video for my documentary project that I'm working on. And I can't edit the video. Why? Because I don't have anything fast enough to use a scratch disk to be able to create the video format that I want to use. So I'm kind of boned. It's literally too slow on a mechanical drive. It's even too slow for an SSD. And several even cheap SSDs that are out there on the market still can't keep up, and it's just horrible waiting for read and write speeds. So I decided I was finally going to bite the bullet and start looking at IO Fusions. They're server class drives that have shown up from servers. They have popped up recently all over the place because people were talking about how these cache drives work, their benefits, their drawbacks, their speed rewrites, you know, a lot of really interesting things. So I went online and I thought, okay, I'll buy one. They're not expensive. They're $60, $70, and sometimes you can get a pretty good deal. Well, I bought something that I wasn't expecting to show up, and that's where this story gets uniquely odd. So I will explain to you how uniquely odd this gets. You ready? So I went on eBay, and I purchased what is called an IO Fusion, and it is supposed to be a 1.65 terabyte model of the IO Fusion. Instead, they just grab some random card off the lot. Remember that these are pulled out of servers, so when people scrap these, they just pull them out, put them on eBay. They don't care. They don't read the back of them. They don't do any of this stuff. They literally do not read the back of the card. They really should, and I will explain why. I was expecting a 1.65 terabyte card. That's what I purchased. Instead, I got a 3.6 terabyte card with, it's not an IO Fusion, it's an IO Memory SX350. Interesting. Same theory, it's still an IO Fusion technically, but it just has more storage and a different type of controller, and it was designed to use a more modern version of Windows. It was originally designed to use with Windows Server 2012. So fairly recent card. I was really beyond myself, because I was like, okay, this is going to go really outside of my realm of drives, because you have to manually configure everything. And boy, did I ever. I want to thank really, really, really one YouTuber in particular. And let me look up his video here real quick, ladies and gentlemen. Because if it wasn't for his video on these larger drives, I never would have ever gotten this thing up and running. Because what is quite shocking is his information on how to get it configured and everything was really, really freaking nice. Homeowners, his channel is Farkle0079. And he has 4,200 subscribers. I will put a link for this video in the description of the video. Really go check out his link. His information really did help in getting this card up and running. Because he basically gave me the information of where I needed to go to get drivers for this specific card, because this specific card actually requires a driver from Western Digital, and you have to log in to a free Western Digital account in order to get the drivers for this card. And then the big problem is you have to also firmware update this card before you can use it. And that's where people get the largest challenge in this. And I will explain why, and it's kind of odd when you need to firmware update this card. So you install the drivers and you're immediately assuming that you're just going to use the card as is. You are not. This is designed to install a tool set that runs by command prompt or terminal in Windows. You have to run it as administrator, and then you've got access to all of the terminal commands that you need to run this drive to get it set up, formatted, and working with a copy of Windows or Windows Server. The first thing you have to do is do the FIA or FIO status to check the drive, make sure it's working, make sure it's there. You then have to make sure that you turn on the voltage regulation, because if you don't, the card is just going to stay in minimal mode and never fire up to full extent. This means that you have to set the overdrive parameter to 75 watts for a few of these cards. Not all of them, but most of them. Once you get that up and running, then what you get is you can then firmware update. And this is where things threw me for a loop, and a big loop, okay? You have to input an FTC command, and I will walk you through all of this in part two of this, and it's a fudged up command that you have to type in. And it's this FAO or IO / update / D / FTC dev 0 / keep going down the list. It's really screwy on how this works. Once you get the manual update of the firmware installed so that the firmware matches the drive, so that you, bam, have the two talking to each other, you can then go into Windows Disk Management, and it will actually show up as a blank drive that says either foreign media or unformatted media, depending upon the drive and what it was originally used for or formatted for. And then you just basically right-click the darn thing, new simplified partition, format it, blow everything off of there, you're done. And your drive's up and running, no problem. These were set up as enterprise SSDs. The difference that I've noticed, which is weird, is for some odd reason, I have found that the computer is a lot more snappier with the card installed. I do not know if that is because Windows is using the cache drive to offload things to speed it up, but I can easily copy a 500 megabyte file in a split second. And I don't mean like, oh, it brings up the window that says copying file. No, I can literally just grab the file, drag it over, let go, and it's on the drive. It's that quick. And then I noticed the controller it was using. It's using a SCSI controller. It's actually a SCSI device. And I was like, that's really uniquely weird. But then I went and found the manual for it, and that's where things get even weirder. The manual's from 2020. So this is a way more recent drive than I was expecting. And I was like, cool, I've got a more recent drive, recent firmware, good driver on it, and the drive is working great. It'll be perfect for video editing and absolutely great. And these cards are showing up for like $70, $80, $90. Just make sure that you stay away from the cards that are metal body. You'll see them. They look like stainless steel heat sinks around them. Those cards do require special software, and you have to buy the software in order for the card to function. And those cards are basically garbage without that software. So you really do not want to buy a card with a giant metal heatsink on it. If you do that, you're getting robbed. don't do that. Not worth it. But what have I noticed from my learning experience with this drive? A lot. First off, I learned how to successfully get the drive running. I learned how to get the drive initialized correctly so that Windows would use it as a drive. I've noticed that it has actually sped up Windows for some weird reason. I can't explain why. I can't even begin to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, at home, why this sped up, okay? I can't. At all. I cannot tell you. I have no clue why it did this. Whether it's Windows caching things to this drive, because this drive does not format at the full 3.6 terabytes. It only formats at 2.8 terabytes. So, is the rest of the storage space being used for caching? And if it is, this is quite an impressive little piece of tech because, wow, I mean, the speed coming out of this thing alone is just sick as hell. But that's what I've been dealing with. I hope that this video uploads correctly, praying to God, because this video right now is being recorded on the I/O memory card. So, tell me what you think. Interesting? I very muchly think so. Peculiar? Very muchly peculiar. Useful? Actually, yes. It's quite interesting little piece of kit to pick up. And I just picked one of these up because I've got a free slot for it. See, I had tried the wireless HTC Vive adapter, and that didn't go so well. I'll explain why you never want to put your HTC Vive on wireless as long as you live. That adapter is a piece of literally. So that card went bye-bye real quick, and so did the wireless on the HTC Vive. That just did not function. Yeah, we're not going to go into that one. That was a $500 blunder, and I do mean $500. Yeah. Well, you know, you go in the hole for some things. But anyways, that's what I can say right now about these I/O Fusion drives. If you get one that's I/O memory, that's the SX350, like what I got, nice drive. I'm not depressed with my purchase, and this thing is wicked. I haven't even pushed this thing on a load yet or anything, and it's just snappy as a mother. Thank you all for stopping by. Have a lovely evening, and take care.